in it.
I spent a lot of time sort of looking at the detail, and I've studied every sort of 3D map, aerial map possible, planning routes and planning where I was going to take off initially, which was great entertainment, but actually it was a waste of time. What the hell am I doing here, really? Middle of nowhere. Trying to find somewhere to take tomorrow after today's dismal attempt. There will be times where I'll be crossing country which I won't be able to land in. Taking off is optional, but landing isn't. You have to land in small spaces. It's part of the territory of actually landing top of a mountain. Sorry to bother your game. You play caution to the big clouds, knowing that actually if they start sucking too hard, they'll suck you up and you become totally disorientated and you could pass out quite easily.
That stopped me.
Yeah, and I think it's part of the game. Fear is part of the game, but it's controlling it.
It's a committed launch today, I think. I'm not so worried. I don't know.
It can be quite lonely. If you're on top of a mountain and it's gone dark at 6:30 at night, it's a long time until it comes light again. Actually, the intensity of it was far greater than I could have imagined.
Please, sir, here. Just hopefully just escorting me back to civilization.
It was a road. Landslide. Not easy to concentrate in firmling when you're getting dive bombed by an eagle.
Oh, I am feeling pushed.
And what I saw, what I experienced, and the people I met.
Stayed at Dan's uncle's house last night. Very traditional farmhouse.
You can't envisage that before you set off, and it brought to tears at times. But at the same time, it was just so elating.
Yeah. Finally.
Just beyond any conception I had before I left.
Yes. Oh my God.
Why am I doing this solo? I don't think anyone else was going to come with me.
Okay, so I hope you all enjoyed the video there. It didn't look like it was playing very well at all, but hopefully we'll be able to include a link or something a bit later on, and you can go back and have a look at the videos, all of the videos that will be included in tonight's talk. Hopefully we'll be able to get some links out to you guys, so apologies if it didn't play very well. Anybody who's having sound issues, a couple of people have said about unmuting your system, make sure that when you mute yourself, you only mute your mic and not your speakers and stuff. So hopefully that'll take care of everything. But other than that, a warm welcome and a massive thank you to Steve Mackintosh, or from here on out, Tosh. Tosh, thanks for joining.
Wes, thanks ever so much for getting us on the 831 podcast. This is amazing.
No, my pleasure, mate. Like I said, the Avon Club have gone far and beyond to be able to host the amount of people who we've got watching. So I'm thankful to them.
Yeah, that's incredible. It really is an incredible turnout tonight.
Yeah, it is. And rightly so as well, because the journey that you put together and you went on, the adventure that you had, I knew about it obviously sometime before a lot of people because we're good friends, but it is something that does deserve the audience. So thank you for wanting to sit and share it with us.
Yeah, it's taken a while to sort of get a chance to talk to anyone about it with all the processes of this year and last year. It's actually, it's been great. So it's great that actually now there's a chance for people to hear the story in a bit more detail. And actually there's no one better to interrogate me than someone I've spent many a firmal in. It's actually, so yeah.
So you touch on that actually. So when before we get in, when was the traverse, just to give people the gap, the time that you've had now from doing it and how long you've had to sit on all this? It must have been bubbling in you. How long have you had to sit on this before getting to this point today?
Yes, yeah, so I came back mid-March, really just before lockdown. The traverse story sort of finished as it, at the moment, in Portugal, because that we actually hit COVID and I came back. And so we've been sitting on all this material, wanting to go out there for the clubs to basically sort of share the story, share the sort of the whole adventure. But it's for me, it wasn't worth doing it unless we actually had a sort of a proper medium to do it. And Zoom, up until this point, I don't think was the right medium to do it. But now we're in this environment, I think it's a good time to be doing it.
Yeah, I agree, mate. I think it's the perfect time. And especially for the people who are watching, there's not been a lot for people to get their teeth in with paragliding adventure, so it is perfect. So lots of people here will obviously know you and will have flown with you, but there's also a lot of people who aren't paraglider pilots or don't know you as well. So let's have a little brief overview of how long you've been flying, what actually got you into this crazy game, and then we can dive into what happened from there on.
Yeah, so how far do we go back? I suppose I started paragliding in 1992. I came back from the Bahamas. I was living in the Bahamas and did a lot of diving. And I came back to this country and I wanted something to replace that, that sort of sport. And I had a bit of a gap before my job started. And that looked a bit exciting, sport to be getting into. And actually there's a paragliding school, Sky Dragons, was set up close to my home. So I joined Noel Humphrey's Sky Dragons, started paragliding with him in 92. And I think my first job was in Lincolnshire. So it took me 2 years to get my CP. Fortunately I then moved to Dorset, Wiltshire, and into Ross, which is where I live now. And each year I seem to be doing more hours, more obsessed by the whole thing, to the degree that I've made sure that my job works, that I can actually paraglide when the weather allows it.
So 1992 got you into the sport. Yeah. Slow progression from 1992, I think we'll say.
Compared to some of the new guys that are out there, I'm a slow burn.
Yeah, but you're going from the slow progression, 1992, to boom, the most epic adventure that I've possibly heard of right now. So,
there's others.
So you, from 1992, you started getting into, I'd say you're an XC paraglider pilot within the UK. You fly a lot of XC, but from knowing you and flying with you, you've always been kind of adventurous. And you and I have done some random flights together and just picked places that aren't even sightseeing on and flown.
So careful, Wes. I am the sights officer of South East Wales. Didn't say that.
But for even someone like myself, when I heard that you were doing this, or when you proposed it to me, I was a bit shocked, because I mean, there's no getting away from it. It's a big deal, right? This is a massive adventure. So what was your motivation? Have you always had your eye on this? Is it somewhere you'd visited before and thought this would be good? What was your motivation to do this traverse and why Nepal?
The idea started, I think the year before. I went out to Nepal, met my daughter Izzy out there. She'd just passed her CP in the summer and she was on a world year out travel. And we decided to meet in Pokhara, do some flying together in Pokhara. And I just started doing a little bit of vol biv in Southeast Wales, you know, one night out. And I thought, if I'm going to go out to Pokhara coaching my daughter, I need something at the end of that to really give me some excitement. So I put together my vol biv kit as it was then. And actually, at the end of being with Izzy, I took 4 days out, changed my flight because the weather was just changed to a better weather conditions, and went on a 3-night, 4-day vol biv, which was epic. It was, I mean, that to me, I think the moment of anyone doing vol biv, the moment you go over a mountain and you've got all you need to survive for a few days and you don't have to worry about getting back, it's a liberation. You're free. You are totally free. Where you end up is anywhere you want to be at that point.
And sometimes where, not where you want to be.
And it was just, it's so exciting. And so I had this three nights, two in the tent, one in a tea house, heading from Pokhara out to Hembulchuli, which is not very far. It's only sort of 60 kilometers, 80 kilometers east of Pokhara. So it wasn't a big distance, but the adventure was massive. And came and back in a day. And it was, to me, that was amazing. And I came back from that and I thought, you know, what's the next step here? Where do I go? And being in Nepal 20 years ago, I'd always wanted to go to the far west of Nepal. So it's that was a sort of a place I started thinking about. And then the idea of the whole traverse sort of manifested itself over the year. So it wasn't an instant thing. It was sort of a slow progression. And as the year went on, I started doing more and more research, started watching a few videos, and it became just the obsession that I wanted to do it. And it really wasn't until I think I booked my permit from Nepal in November that then that was the point I thought.
So you knew you wanted to evolve Biv,
yeah,
but you didn't know what you were going to do. So does that mean that even when you went to do the adventure, you still didn't know your journey? You didn't know where you were trying to get to, or you just had it in your head, I want to go from here to here and I don't care how I get there? Or was there like a route that you had planned?
I planned it quite well, really. It was a bit of a pointless exercise, I think I might have said on the video. I planned it quite well, and the idea of the whole traverse, I think I started looking at what other people had done out in Nepal in terms of distances and stuff, and actually started talking to a few people. Adam West was the guy who was a great reference. He's obviously started off the paragliding in Nepal back in the 90s, and he was a great help, sort of giving me some insight. And then I started looking at what other people had done in terms of sort of flights, and it became apparent not many had done, well, no one's really done the full traverse as I did it, or as I tried to do it. There's been like six or seven major, really great flights which have been recorded out there. And I think the first probably was the Himalayan Odyssey, where there were seven guys headed up by Brad Sanders. And the seven pilots took off and they aimed to get to Sikkim on the east side of Nepal, and famously got arrested at that point. But I think two of them did it then.
That sounds like an adventure. Yeah, let's teach them guys.
And then after that, there was a tragic incident with a couple of guys. It was Mitch Riley and Pramit Hulick, who sadly, it was a tragic accident sort of 60 kilometers out from Pokhara with him. So that was sort of an eye opener, really, I suppose. And yeah, Mitch stopped at Pokhara. And then there have been some other great flights by pairs of pilots. Boxy and another guy have done from Sidikot to Pokhara, and there's been a few other guys. But no one had actually done what I was trying to do, was go beyond Pokhara and try and do the whole traverse. And no one had done it solely.
So the traverse that you wanted to do and you had in mind, how far are we talking? We obviously talking kilometers. So how far are we, as a crow flies, straight line, what would we be talking kilometers start to finish if it was to go that way?
800 kilometers about.
Okay.
Which in the UK isn't that far, I suppose. And you could do it in about five flights, couldn't you?
Yeah. I mean, it's one end to the other at least. So it's quite far. But yeah, so 800 kilometers, that's as the crow flies. Obviously, you're not going to take that route. You're going to go all different kinds of routes. But you felt your history, you had plenty of history, mountain flying experience in these regions to do it, or was it just simply, I went to Nepal, enjoyed the flying, yeah, that's enough for me, I can handle this, I'll go back again?
I had mountain experience, and I think I reassured myself when I was out in Nepal the year before that actually I could nail very tight landings on top of a mountain. And my glider, which I've had for quite a while, I can usually get it out to quite a tight spot to sort of get in the air. So, although it didn't always happen this time. So I felt I had the armory and my skill to do it. And I went with the idea that actually I wasn't going to put myself in a position where if I couldn't do it, I didn't think I could do it, I wasn't going to do it. So I sort of had a survival instinct.
Okay, so you come home, you've been out there, you've met your daughter, you've had a small Vol Biv. You come home, how quickly when you get back, are you starting to plan the trip? And then subsequently, once you've planned the trip, how quickly are you then embarking on the trip?
Yeah, the conversation with the wife was the first one. And once I had the sort of like the amber to green, then I felt I could actually start, you know.
That's your first visa. That's the first visa. Get that one stamped.
First visa obtained. I can now actually have a conversation with other people about it. So that was, I guess, May probably. And then the summer sort of went through. And it was really sort of September, October, I started searching on maps and searching. And I, you know, went out to Covent Garden and trolled for the guidebooks on the far west and Nepal and as much research as I could do, really. But there wasn't actually a lot of material out there that was only value to what I ended up doing.
Yeah, so you've come back, you've started your research, planning, I'm going to go back out when?
I had sort of kind of hoped to go out in the autumn, but it's the spring, to try and get the weather post-winter, pre-sort of...
So you're giving yourself almost a year,
yeah,
really, of planning.
Was a year. It was nearly sort of a year on.
Yeah, and I guess we'll find out whether that was enough as it goes on. As the talk goes on, we'll find out if a year's planning is enough for something like this. So... This has never been done by anybody before.
Not solo.
Not solo. And so you've got very limited information.
There was one crazy French guy called Blutch who flew from Tajikistan to Sikkim.
Yes. He's actually got a film out,
right? Great film. Yeah. Blutch, the film Discovery Watch. And that was an inspiration to me. That was, the main difference was he took 4 months. I didn't have 4 months. He took a violin. I felt that was excessive.
And you don't know how to play the violin?
Well, nor did he. If you've seen the film, he has one tune. so that, yeah, he was probably the only person I've known to do it purely solo, yeah.
Okay, so you come back, you know you're going to use your wing. How much of the other equipment necessary did you feel you had? Or was there a case now, right, I need to really get back. I've got the route roughly where I need it to be. Now I need to plan the next stage. The next stage I'm gathering would have been equipment planning, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sensibly would be. I mean, there's a couple of things. You've done it as a test run with those 4 days where a test run. You come back, you're thinking, actually, I need to sort that out. And I need that didn't work, that did work. So it was a really good test of what I had already acquired. And then I realized there were some things which I needed to up the game of. I got really cold last time, so it was a case of actually I need to get a puffer down jacket, I need to get a proper sleeping bag, I need to ensure that actually I can survive a night at 4,000 meters when it drops to whatever it did drop to. So I suppose I then started talking to who became my sponsors, really, sort of Fly Bubble and Trek It Mountain Sports. So sort of, you know, talking to them, I managed to develop a shopping list and obviously saved a bit of money by working with them to get my kit in order.
So you've got your kit. When I did the XPR, I had a kit bag which weighed about, with everything, flight instruments all in together, about 8.5-9 kilos all up. What are you talking weight-wise, food? What's your kit bag empty before you take provisions, water and food?
Yeah, water and food were quite a bit, especially at the beginning. Got lighter as I went. just over 20.
That's your naked kit, just over 20. Yeah, and then add food and stuff as well?
I got to 24 and a half, I think, when I first set off.
24 and a half kilos.
Weighed in before actually starting, but yeah. But three litres of water is 3 kilos.
Exactly. Yeah, and so what you take in, what's in your kit bag? So if we're going to talk through what's in your kit bag, we know sleeping bag, obviously, tent.
Actually, we've got a slide we can throw up there, actually. If Sean can throw that up and we can just talk about the kit.
Yeah, a little selection of your kit.
Yeah.
Because when I first saw this picture that Sean will hopefully put up now, I was shocked at how much equipment went into your bag.
I didn't include the table.
Oh, that's... No, actually, no, that looks much more appropriate. Yeah,
the table didn't fit, so I had to leave that behind.
Yeah, so this is your kit bag, which, I mean, okay, the XPR is not comparable to something like this, but even for a Vol-Biv, that looks excessive, but I've not done a Vol-Biv in Nepal, and I guess you haven't. So provisions, what sort of thing have you got in that bag? Just briefly.
Yeah. Clothing wise, I didn't actually take an awful lot. I basically had I had the clothes I was wearing, a spare pair of socks and, you know, a couple of a spare t-shirt and that sort of stuff. And that was, I kept that to a minimum with a view that I could wash stuff. The food for cooking, I had a jet boil, spare gas. And there's a whole story about about gas. These are the challenges you're faced when you're trying to do these sort of things. I'm going to digress here. The thing started in Kathmandu, and in Kathmandu I bought my gas cylinders, which fit inside the jet boil, and jumped into, on the taxi, got to the airport, and as I put my bag for the x-ray, the guy on the other side of the x-ray, bear in mind, it's not like, it's just a guy sitting there with an x-ray machine between us, he goes, "You can't take gas." I said, there's no gas, water bottle, no gas. And he showed me the x-ray, and the gas bottle came through the jet boil, and it said gas on it. It's like, okay, you got me.
hands up on this one.
And the story continues on that. It's actually in the fact that I managed to, he said, "You can't take it." I said, "Well, I need it," because I was flying to an airport, which I knew I wouldn't get any gas. So actually, this is instantly going to, cold food and et cetera for the next 3 or 4 weeks is not going to be great. So I said, "I need to take it." So I sort of showed him 1,000 rupee note, and he goes, "No, so you can ask the airline." So I went to the airline counter, and they were checking in the flight before mine at the time, so he was enough time to talk to me. So I sat down for a while, and then went back up, and then basically they sort of said, "No, come back in a minute, and I'll get my superintendent to come across and see if we can accept the gas on there." I'm getting quite conscious now, time's ticking on. So I basically went back to the guy at X-ray and said, "Yeah, they're fine with that." He said, "Are they sure?" He said, "Yeah, fine." I said, "Do you want the 1,000 rupee? And he said, no, I'll come find you later. So he gave me gas bottles and I went through.
I don't feel like I know this international gas smuggling, bribing top.
No, so I think some people take kerosene instead, or just light fires. But
Some
bear people in mind, if you're in Kathmandu Airport, they can spot your gas. But anyway, so there's gas. There's a cooking stove in there for the food, and that was my main cooker, gas bottles. So I've got a tent, a sleeping bag, and a roll mat. The sleeping bag was actually my most expensive bit of kit. I wasn't going to mess around this time. So yeah, it's a man's equipment, firelight, down on it. Yeah, pretty amazing.
Whoa. We're not hearing most expensive a bit of kit without hearing a price. No. People will be Googling this and start watching. How much are we talking?
£400.
£400 quid sleeping bag.
I had sponsorship.
Yeah, and I bet it was worth every penny anyway.
Yeah, totally. And actually, I get cold at night. I suffer from the cold big time. So actually to be, in a cozy sleeping bag at night, you need to get good sleep. So yeah, it was good. And then tent wise, your same tent, waterproof, draft proof, just about, roll mat, and then the electronics, solar panel, battery chargers, that sort of thing. This goes on actually. There were only a few things which I took, which I didn't need. And there's probably only a couple of things which I didn't take, which I should have taken.
The question everybody wants to know, the answer to, I'm sure, is, did you use all your underwear?
I only took one pair.
So that's yes, you used all your underwear then, definitely.
Yeah, so I only took one. So yeah, as I said, I took some soap, a multi-purpose soap to wash stuff with, found the occasion.
So what about the logistics of filming and stuff? You just thought, I'll just take multiple SD cards and keep them safe?
Yeah, so yeah, that's another story. It was actually quite a task. I met with Martin Cray to film it. We decided to make this into a decent film. So instantly I'm thinking, right, I need to up my game. So I took a GoPro Hero 8 and I took a mirrorless digital SLR. I wanted to be sure I could actually capture the good images, which were, on the ground, as well as having the sort of the GoPro type footage. So yeah, a lot of time spent backtracking, thinking about the shots I was going to take. I captured an awful lot of footage, but that did take a lot of energy. And then you got all the charging to do with the batteries, etc. It was quite a conscious effort to make that sort of a catalogue of footage. And then you've got all your data cards, of course, which you need to collate. It took some doing.
Yeah, so I guess you didn't have any, where to unload any of the data. So I guess you were conscious of, don't fill these cards, or I'm not going to be able to delete the footage that I have got. Then if you did have to, it's, what do I delete? Like, I'm going to need all of this. How long did you plan the trip would take?
I thought I'd nail it. I thought I'd get to Pocker in a couple of weeks.
Yeah.
It took longer. And I thought maybe if I had a month, I could get to the whole thing.
Yeah. 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 So when you get to Pokhara, when you get to Kathmandu, you know you've got to where you've got to get to. You leave the airport. You're right. Where do you head? Where's the start base? We're starting here.
Yeah, west. So I took a flight, and in the pressure of the evening, I'll probably forget names now. So Dagadeni is an airport on the southwest corner of Nepal, borders India. It's actually a border entry point.
Yeah.
For international travellers as well. I arrived there. Unfortunately, my flight was massively delayed. So the flight I was getting at 7 a.m. now took off at 12 a.m. India and Nepal suffer a lot from inversion and fog. And so the visibility was bad back in Dagadeni. So eventually arrived about 12 o'clock. I had anticipated being there a lot earlier, and I wanted to get a bus north from there to a place called... come to me in a minute, up towards Darchula.
Don't worry about names, mate, nobody watching's done it. You're the only one who's done it. Make them up, it's fine.
The good thing about doing this solo was I could just make it up, couldn't I?
Yeah, exactly. Just make it up. We'll believe you.
Yeah.
I would have if it wasn't for the bribery story.
Yeah. So basically, I arrived about midday, got a taxi to a little bus stop. And the bus stop's not as you imagine. It was actually the first slide on those slides we showed. It's just basically a dirty area on the side of a road where the bus is set off from. I then had a seven-hour bus journey north. Arrived, and it was into this sort of hill town, not massive hill town, at sort of 8 o'clock at night, I think it was, when I arrived there. And yeah, it's, you know, dark, no street lights. Where do you stay? Yeah. Managed to find a hotel that night, and then in the morning sun comes up and you feel much better.
Yeah. So you started on time. You didn't delay a day because of the delay. You still started the next day.
Yeah, so then from there, north again, another 8-hour bus journey. Wow. And initially, I'm sort of getting quite worried because actually most of that time, the first day, was just through forest. I'm thinking, this is not going to work. There's no hills to fly over here. You know, Google Maps has lied to me on this one. But I was heading up to Darchula, which is on the Indian border and is another border post, but just... and that was my sort of like big plan. But on the way, I was heading up and I was going to stop in a place called Gogli Shaw, which is a small town before Darchula. And I thought I was going to have to get a jeep then from there to Darchula. But on the way, there's this mountain range. And you'd probably appreciate it. And all paragliders would appreciate seeing this beautiful, look like grass-covered mountain with little cumulus popping off it, heading out in the direction you want to go. So as I was going on this bus, I was like... oh my God, that looks perfect. But I'm on a bus, it's not stopping. What do? I stop it? Do I jump off? This is the only bus. If I jump off now, I'm staying there that night. And yeah, procrastination, the hesitation, I carried on. So the whole journey back down or on down to Gogli Shaw was actually, I should have got off. Too late.
One missed thermal though would have put you right back, feet on the ground again, waiting for a bus. So
yeah. So anyway, Gogli Shaw, and the next day I thought I'm going back up there. So rather than carrying on to the very border of India, I came back sort of 30k in, back to this mountain range, and I thought this is where I'm going to start. Yeah.
Climb the mountain range.
Yeah.
Let's start here. So planning now, once you get there, what's your plan for route as an instrument? What are you using? Mm. And what's your plan for, say, I'm guessing weather must be a big issue. What's your plan for like weather forecasting, etc.? You know, how are you going to prepare for, I'm here, this is it. You know, like,
yeah,
I'm going to climb the hill, I'm going to take off. We all know logistically that's not how it's going to go. So how are you prepared? Air maps, what are you using? And weather forecast. maps, so what are you going to use?
They haven't been done for the four ways.
What are you going to use for maps?
Okay. So, I mean, the weather, let's talk about the weather. Weather was the biggest challenge I had. It changed massively when I was on my journey. I came back to actually using Windy on my phone. Okay. And actually on phones then, because there's been no terrestrial landline built into Nepal, everywhere has got antennas, which are solar panels. So the phone signal in quite remote areas is really quite good. So I was able to get, you know, quite often, you know, 3G, 4G in the middle of nowhere. It was quite incredible. So windy was a great one for me. The basics are windy. And then when I didn't have a signal, good old Ali Andrews from Kakal, he stepped in to help me message on the inReach, the sort of the heads up of what was coming in the next forecast. For me, it was about being sure that if actually the next day was flyable, I was ready to make the most of it. And if it wasn't flyable, if it was going to rain, then actually I was prepared to sort of stay low and maybe travel to somewhere where I could get high again for the following day. So it was just knowing what was happening. The weather at the time was what it was. And I flew in conditions which you wouldn't really fly in if you were just in a leisure activity. But because I was sort of on an obsession to get somewhere, I sort of tried to seize every moment I could to get a flight in, whatever that was, 10K, 60K, just to keep the movement going.
Really. Yeah, I mean, that's good for not just progress, but mentally, that's really good as well. So first day is I'm going to call this first day once you decide on where I'm going to take off from. You know, you've got the traveling out of the way. Day one, you're at this mountain range that you've come 30K back to get to. You, I guess, now climb the hill. This is where it starts. You've not camped or anything at this point. You've had I don't know what the conditions are like to sleep, but fairly okay conditions to sleep, I'm assuming. And now you're at the point where I'm walking up my first hill to start this adventure. What does that feel like and what are you presented with?
Totally excited, I suppose. It's building all the time, actually, this anticipation. Is this going to work? Because, you know, potentially you've built yourself up for a big fall here. You've actually sort of committed yourself to be somewhere where it's going to take you at least 3 days to get home. If it's not going to be flyable, if I can't do it, it's going to be a good story too, I'm sure. But I took the view that actually it was an adventure, and the flying to me, and the beauty of paragliding, as you would know, Wes, is actually it takes you to places where you would never ever go.
Exactly.
If you were going as a tourist or on a normal transport. So here I was in a place where no one would normally go already before I even flown.
Yeah, so, and even paraglider pilots haven't even chose to go there. So less people have wanted to go there. I'm here now. It was very much a case
of... This is what we've got. We'll make the most of it.
Yeah, this is what I'm fronted with. We'll make the most of it. So this mountain range, the first one you get to, how high are we talking? What's the start?
I topped out at 2,700 metres.
This is your first takeoff? This is where you...
No, I took off at 2,200, I think. So I wasn't at the top. So, that was... The next story, I suppose, is I took me a day to take off.
Okay. to be fair, she would prep your kit.
So what you've got to appreciate with Nepal landscapes is that the grass that looks like grass from a distance is actually not grass. It's just covered in thorn bushes and rocks. And if it is grass, it's far too steep to take off. And there's trees in the front of it. So wherever you think it's grass, it's actually got the trees that get over. So I covered most of the hill trying to find a takeoff for the first day, which some of those takeoffs were pretty rad. Yeah, I was trying to launch from a track with some Nepali ladies that had been walking past with baskets of wood, holding my glider. So I tried to sort of explain to them, just hold it, just hold this. Yeah, when I go, okay, you let go, and I pull it up, and I take off. Doesn't work.
No. No, let go. I tried on the Malverns with English people. It didn't work.
Didn't work. The fact I was on the track, and the wind was coming from the... Well, there's no wind. It was like, so that didn't work. So, forward launch doesn't work. Yeah, so anyway, a hot, sweaty day. Big frustration, because it was beautiful. It was a good flying day. Anyway, I found a nice place to stay that night, and that was cool.
So you had to walk back down to find somewhere.
No, I stayed high. I camped high first night. Yeah, I'm doing it. The tent's out. At least I'm using that. even the wings.
I wouldn't worry about the tent. It's that sleeping bag.
Yeah.
I'd be sleeping in that even if I was in a hotel.
No, it was, I did sleep in that even if I wasn't in the hotel because it was at least clean. The sheets were suspect. So yeah, first night out, and you talk about the route. You, and all the plans are put in place. All this Google map searching I'd done. All these sort of like lines on Google Earth. I'd put, drawn everything out, that range there and that sort of stuff was actually. Well, that was at the window now because I was now starting from somewhere else. So instantly, you know, that plan of your route is basically out of the tent, and actually your plan now is just go east-ish.
Yeah. Get back onto the route somehow.
Yeah, just you know, you are sun on your right.
Yeah.
You're sorted. So that was the sort of the next.
So day two, wake up. What's the conditions looking like now? You're going to try and hike up to the same place you were trying to take off the day before. Do you now have some wind? Is the situation different? What are you presented with on your next day, waking up in your tent?
Sunshine. Yes.
Yeah.
So next day, and you come back to this camera thing, don't you? So instantly you're up the hill, slowly record the sunset coming up, pictures of the tent, sort of doing this, pictures of me having breakfast. It's just like, you know, so you've got this sort of background task running in your head, thinking, I've got to film this, I've got to take some footage, I need to, you know, record every moment if I can.
Because, I mean, I guess it's important to realise that you never did this because you wanted to make a film, but at the same time, you're thinking, well, this could make a good film.
Yeah.
So if you think that from day three, you've missed, it's never going to make a film because you've missed these bits. So if you were going out there with the mindset that you're a filmmaker and you want to do this, but I believe you didn't even have any YouTube content before you'd gone out there or something, did you? No. So you're not a filmmaker.
YouTube channel.
But you're not a filmmaker, basically. So it's not the first thing that comes to your mind. So now you're going out there thinking, I'm having this amazing adventure. It would be cool if I can also put a film together. But because that's a secondary thought, that's obviously a big drain on yourself because you're thinking, do I film myself trying to take off and failing when I could have took off and missed the thermal? Yeah. How do I approach this?
Well, I think it was a case of I just tried to grab every opportunity I could to film. And inevitably, some takeoffs I didn't film because, you can be sort of like anticipating a takeoff for 5-10 minutes possibly. And if you had your GoPro running for that long, you'd run out of storage and battery. Yeah. And so you end up thinking, oh, flywheel, up, go. And other times I'm sort of sitting there going, okay, I've just wasted 5 minutes of footage, waiting for something to sort of blow through and I can launch into. So the next day, I'd spotted a bit of a clearing on this one bank, a bit higher up than I'd sort of in a very strange place where I'd been the day before. And I basically went there, sussed it out, laid out, cleared the thorn bushes from that little spot, hid my bag. It was quite early. So I walked, I was conscious now, I didn't have much water. So I walked a couple of hours, an hour there, an hour back, just to get some more water. Got back, bag was still in the bushes, laid out. And took off. It was a pretty sketchy takeoff, to be fair. I remember sort of just dodging and kicking a tree on the way out. I was in the air.
But you're in the air. First time in the air. And what do you launch into? Good climbs, or you have to find? You have to
fly up. Straight up. And actually, it will show a little montage of flying halfway through all this. And actually, that first part of that shows my climb out. And I was joined by 6-10 vultures. And I'd seen them earlier in the day before, sort of enjoying it. And they joined me, I joined them. You've flown some big vultures. These guys have never flown a paraglider before. They were coming straight at me. He's going, whoa, you know, he's just like dropping out the sky.
Yeah, they're like, of all the birds you fly with, they're stoned, 100%. They don't mean you any harm, no. They're just stoned.
Yeah, they were just chilling in the thermal, thinking, yeah, let's go around this guy. This is fun, you know. And actually, every now and again, you won't see it tonight, but on some of the, you'll see it in the film. A couple of times I'm shouting, whoa! You know, as this vulture goes, whoa, who's that? And off he goes. Anyway, top of the thermal.
So, first of all, the takeoff, for the people who aren't paraglider pilots who are watching,
must remember that.
When you take off for the first time, that feeling, I wasn't there. This is important that people know. I've not heard this story. I'm hearing it now for the first time.
No one has.
I imagine when you take off, there's at least a few whoops and a yee-haw because your adventure doesn't really start until your feet are off the ground, right? Yeah. It's a paragliding vol biv trip. So the paragliding is a fundamental part, or you're going for a walk. Yeah. So when those feet leave the ground the first time, I should imagine there's some whoops and some elation, and you feel, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but you feel like this is the start, man. We're away.
And actually, interestingly, you know, after how many years of flying I've been doing, you settle into the harness, and it's like, okay, I can do this.
Yeah.
This is going to work. Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's, yeah, it is. And actually my first whoop was just to a shepherd that had been watching me for most of the morning, tendering his goats, and the goats had little bells on them, like being in the Alps, really. And I sort of gave him a whoop whoop as I went past. He'd be trying to explain when he got home about this guy who flew and the people. anyway, so, and it just, yeah, the first climb all the way up, blue, not a single cloud. I got to sort of 3,500 meters. And you had to be there. But so here I am, I'm looking at India, I'm looking at the Appi Mountains, I'm looking at the Sepi Mountains, and I'm just looking at the distance of the mountains beyond. And it's just awesome. Yeah.
Did you feel like you'd bitten off more than you can chew, or did you feel like, wow, like this is it? Everything's
buzzing,
a bit.
I was buzzing. Yeah. Absolutely buzzing. And the Himalayas are different to the Alps. The Himalayas have, I guess it's because it has been thrust up out of the earth and haven't really been glaciated, but there's not the formation that you get in the Alps with the valleys and the sort of the hanging valleys. This is just a maze of valleys. There seems to be no structure to it. So you're looking across this this maze of ridges and it's quite awe-inspiring, really. I remember when I was talking to Greg Hamilton about it, he said, well, actually, if I zoom out enough, you're just doing a ridge run, which it looks like it is. The Himalayas do that. But actually, in between the detail, there's valleys and gorges and spurs.
And you're going to be between the detail quite a lot, I should imagine.
It is. It's, yeah.
So that first day, lift was quite consistent for you, or you were working hard? What you pushed east, I'm guessing, from what you said. What does the first day entail? How far did you get? Where did you land? Do you land high? Do you land because you have to? You know, what was the first day?
It was a good day, actually. I not massive distances. No day is massive, really. I think I did about 35K. Got to the end of this valley and just couldn't climb out of this valley. It was just, it was just nothing working. Even the vultures had left. And so I was caught on this end of this valley, couldn't get into the next one for ages. And eventually I had a couple of choices. I either sort of sidelined it or went down to the beautifully green paddy fields at the bottom. And I thought, well, let's be safe first day. And landed. And there was the first welcome committee that I was to experience for the rest of the journey. And actually we've got a little montage of the welcome committee, and if Sean can play that now.
Yeah, because this would be one of my big questions. I guess there's going to be a lot of fear from people who want to pursue this sort of thing about how you're going to get met. What are you going to get greeted by? Generally, wherever I've flown in the world, wherever you land, people are good. But if Sean plays the montage of the landing, I was shocked when that got sent over to us, and you're saying this is how it sort of starts and it carried on.
And this became a regular feature. And actually, it's sort of,
I think that's the wrong one. That's the flying montage, isn't it? It's the landing one.
Don't give him this one.
Don't give him this one, Sean.
And interestingly, on this instance, I understood later that actually all the older ladies in the village, because I'd been flying around this valley for quite a while, had all gone and hidden in the houses. They were fearful of this thing flying over their village. They'd taken it as some dark omen. This village I landed in, I think it was Telic, had only ever seen two Westerners before. Wow. And they were two Americans who'd been there passing the word of God on. And that was some time back. So, you know, third Westerner to the village. And really, it was just an amazing reception. And interestingly, this is just then shows you the maps I was using. On the map I have, which is this one here in front of me, the village is in the wrong valley. That's how accurate the maps are. It's you know, the this tiny villages tucked away in little valleys. It was, yeah, incredible.
So Sean's struggling with that, obviously. I can take that from the fact that hasn't been played.
Throw it up when you can.
Yeah, throw it up, Sean. If it's out of context, we'll go back to it. So you land, and this is it. What sort of time of day? Is this the end of your flying day now when you land, or is this...
Here we go. I thought it was good to start.
So this is your welcoming committee.
This is just typical daily scenes after landing. Sort of average, sort of like a congregation to watch me pack away.
So most places you land, you're greeted with these kind of scenes. Yeah. I guess on the first day, it's a bit daunting. All these people running over to you, don't know what's going to happen, obviously.
Yeah.
But then after day one, so what happens after this? Do you take off again, or these people greet you, they invite you to come with them, spend time with them? You have to spend time with them. They're going to want pictures with you, and they're going to know what you're doing, and they're going to try and communicate with you.
Yeah, so the thing is I'm flying once a day, and so the end of the day you end up with this, and it's a case of actually where do you go from here. It was an adventure to me, and I didn't. To me, this where I landed was part of the whole unknown adventure that I was actually having. So when you arrive in the village, you're welcome. The people you start talking to start dictating the next step in your adventure. It's an interesting scenario. So am I going to be invited into someone's house? Am I going to just walk out the village and go back up the hill? You're taken off that morning. Where you'll end up that day is completely unknown. It's a complete adventure. So the village landings, the landings of other people, to add to that unexpected sort of next step entirely, and nothing ever plays out. No day ever played out the same. Yeah. And days felt like weeks.
Did you start seeking out villages because you knew this sort of welcome that you'd get?
No, I didn't. It was a nice balance. I think the best was to land in the village and be welcomed, or to land in the hill where there's no one. The worst scenario is when you landed in the halfway house position, where you ended up on the edge of a village, and people came to see you. You were trying to stay in the tent, and people were sort of just watching you cook or watching you sort of go to sleep. I'd rather be remote in my tent or in the village taking hospitality or staying in a tea house. So yeah. It's the two I tried to seek out, I suppose.
Yeah, it makes sense. Like full immersion in either.
Yeah. You know,
full immersion in the fact that I'm alone and I'm doing this on my own, or full immersion in the fact that I'm with a new culture and I'm with them, want to see what they're doing, what they're getting up to. So this night, you get greeted. Where'd you spend the night?
That's and interestingly, every time I land in the village, the one point of reference that you have is an English teacher or a teacher, because they're the few people in the village that can actually speak reasonably good English, or very good English in most cases. And so consequently, I know a lot of teachers in Nepal. You end up speaking to these great guys who are very keen to sort of help you. Such sort of welcoming. And the Holy people are so hospitable, so want to sort of, you know, welcome you to their home. So I was really inundated with a place to stay. More often I'd be staying in a tea house because that was just easier. It was because of a spare bed. If I stayed in the farmhouse, it was often taking someone's bed, or someone's house, I'd often taken their bed, which was, you know, it's great, but actually, you know, it's balancing the thing out. This night I ended up spending some time in the village. One of the things I always try to do as a default take five, what am I going to do, is ask for a cup of tea. True English style. I got quite accustomed to the tea. So I'd, you know, just let them sort of like, you know, just have conversations, do the selfies, have a cup of tea, and then you can sort out, okay, what's the weather going to do tomorrow? Where do I want to be tomorrow taking off? Should I stay here? Should I walk out the village and try and get high? So it gave you a chance to sort of, and also a chance for the crowd to disperse. So you go down from, you know, 100, 200, in the entire village, you end up with maybe sort of 50 people down to 20 or so.
How do you choose whose house to stay in? Plenty of offers, I should
have. Just go with the flow. This night I actually stayed on a ridge. In Nepal, there's villages right there, little tiny villages tucked away, or there are these markets they get on the ridge line. So a lot of the roads meet on the top of the ridges. Mm-hmm. And in that area, you end up with all the shops, which end up being like trading posts for wholesalers dropping off and the villagers buying the food there. So like a market town. And this night I stayed on the top of the ridge I've been trying to get across in a tea house, which is great. You know, it's in a sort of very basic room, but downstairs you've got open fire, you know, and you know, cooking.
So
food.
This is where you restock as well. So if you need anything, I guess you don't after the first one, but as time went on, this is where you would stock. You'd land, you'd end up in the village.
Yeah.
What are we talking in the way of shops and stuff? What do you land and what are you presented with to buy, etc.?
Yeah, if I was buying, because with the food I took, I also took I bought noodles and that sort of stuff because it's light, easy stuff to throw in water. But also by landing in a village or somewhere like that, I was able to sort of charge back, you know, get ahead in the charging of all my devices. Because that was a constant challenge. I've got a solar panel, which I had flying out in front of me most of the time when I was flying to sort of charge a battery pack. But inevitably, you're sort of running more battery than you can actually charge up. So it was a great chance to sort of like...
So that was more important in the food, really, like keep my electricity
going. Yeah, to a degree. But actually, food was... Yeah, I'll keep it simple, really.
Yep. So you sleep on the mountain. The next flying day, where'd you head? Further west again?
So the next day was dreadful. It was just...
That's what we wanted to hear. Enough of all the good stuff, less of the bad stuff. So
you open the door and it's just this cloud blowing through, this icy cloud blowing through. You're thinking, okay, today's different. I missed that one. In cloud and it's blowing through at a really fast rate of knots. So obviously it was going to be a different day. And for my idea, that had been to try and take off from somewhere around there. But there was not really an ideal hill. And nothing really sort of grabbed my attention, sort of where to go. So it ended up that day. I actually jumped in on a lorry, which was heading north to a village in the next valley, which I knew would have been great to sort of continue the journey. So in essence, I'd just going to drop down. I would have dropped down on the paraglider, but it was like a 6-hour lorry journey. But I jumped off and flew later.
Yeah, the lorry journey is all part of the adventure, though, right? That's the great thing about not being constrained by the fact it's a race. You have the freedom. That's the main thing. It's okay. We talk about having freedom in a paraglider, and it's a great expression of freedom. It is. We go wherever we like. But on an adventure like this, it's also great to have the freedom to say, I can jump in this lorry. Yeah. And I can take a detour around when I know it's not flyable. That's a day wasted then the next day. Only one day, the next day you're back in the air again?
I did fly, yeah. Okay. So the great thing, again, about being on a lorry or something under your own steam is you can just jump off and take off. Without going into too much boring detail for those that aren't flyers, I came into this village, and dropped down, and we stopped. And you stop on the side of the road for lunch. It's little tea houses, churn out dal bhat for all the travellers. You sit down, you get some dal bhat, then you standard fare, really good normally.
Dal bhat.
Dal bhat. You haven't been to Nepal yet, have you? Yeah.
No, I've never been to Nepal. No.
I'm going to be careful my concert description of dal bhat, but dal bhat is a single plate you get, and it's basically it's a bottomless dish. Okay. So actually,
I'm in.
You're in. It consists of little dishes of rice, inevitably, sometimes some flatbread, some pickles, sometimes some meat dishes, a curry, and lots of different sauces. So it's a great little fare. And if you finish it, there's more on your plate.
And you have to pay for this?
It doesn't cost much, that's for sure. But whilst we're having this dal bhat, as you know, the air above the mountain which now dropped behind looked really good. So I thought, no, I can't just continue. So I was talking to the guy who I've got friends with who's driving the lorry. And I saw this tuk-tuk coming back up the road. I go, I think I'm going to go back. Give me my bag. And this tuk-tuk had no one in it. So it's like, whoa, give me a lift. So amazing. It was empty. And I got a tuk-tuk back up to the village I just come through. And I'd seen this temple sitting on this grass area, and the Nevli temples are surrounded by grass because of, you know, the sort of central places in the market. And so I walked across to this, and it was perfect. Perfect apart from it went straight into a gorge, which was completely full of trees and a fast flowing river. And so I had to know it was going to work. Because I couldn't see an option to land at that point. But yeah, I was in because the air was coming through. It was felt good. You know how it is. Where's you? And I thought, actually, you know, so long as I can get the wing above my head, feeling like it wants to fly, I'm off here. And actually, sure enough, yeah, audience watching didn't help. So second time up in the air, wing was above my head, felt good. Off I go. I climbed up and off. Back in the air, it was brilliant. But then I realised I'd left my water camelback in the back of the lorry. So it's like, boom. Which kind of wasn't okay, but wasn't okay because I needed something to, you know, I needed something to carry a decent amount of water. And also in the air, I wanted to be able to drink in the air. So I knew where the lorry was going. So I basically flew to the town that he was going to and landed. And 2 hours later, he turned up in that little town and I got my camelback back.
Chasing your camelback. So did that hinder your performance for the day flying wise?
Yeah, time, yeah. I would have carried on. That day for sure. Yeah. I weighed up the hassle and the urgency that I needed to. So yeah.
Yeah, I mean, at this point things have gone quite well. So you're thinking, if without water, that's when things are going to start to go. That's when things can start to spiral out of control. And you're like, this is getting worse and worse. And being without water in a really hot country, when it's not flyable as well, lots of walking. Yeah, it makes sense. You go and you land in this village. So that's your flying done for that day, or that was
then? Yeah, that was that day, no reception. But yeah, water was key to my... It's one of the hardest things to get hold of. It's time I was there, a lot of snow had just about melted off, so there wasn't a lot of snow high up. And when you're high, it's actually very dry. There's not a lot of streams. So I was conscious that actually, if by the time you've cooked and used water that day, I was needing 3 liters of water a day, so to really keep myself hydrated. So inevitably, you know, you start off with three kilos of water. The time you get to the end of the day, you're on the end of that, and then you need to find water for the next day. So that was one of the bigger challenges of actually the whole journey, really. So
were you planning your route around finding water? Or?
No, I was fortunate. Most of the time, I was able to sort of top up. So I had my camelback and a liter of water, which I just filled whenever I could. Sometimes I'd actually be just passing a small shepherd's hut or something, going to be a bit of a tap or a street, yeah, coming out of the side of the hill, and just fill up that way. Or,
wow. You know. So that's that day you've put yourself back because you've had to go and land for your water. Next morning, up, cycle over again, walk up to the top of a mountain, or you were partway up the hill at this point?
No, I was on the bottom. And the other thing I sort of made the use of and sort of supported the community was I actually quite often employed someone to carry my bag.
That's also can something I you say, can't do in the XP.
Yes. Do you not do that in the XP?
No.
Don't know why you didn't do that. Top tip, Wes.
So you employ, so people just are there to, I guess they just want to be part of the journey, right? This is unique to them.
Yeah, well, yeah, as a country, they're always carrying stuff up and down mountains. Yeah, so they're used to doing it, and they will pay each other to carry stuff up the mountain. So it's part of how you transport stuff up footpaths. It's sort of a set rate. You know, it's like, you know, how much is so, you know, 500 rupees an hour is the sort of rate that I was working on most of the time.
What's that equate to?
£7, I think. So it's quite good money.
Yeah, that's good money, yeah.
Yeah, good. And to me, it was several advantages to it. One, obviously,
you're not carrying a bag.
You're not carrying a bag. The other one was actually they knew where they were going. Because there's so many paths, and you're crossing old paddy fields, which have got thorn bushes on them, and there's you know, this, it's not clear where to go. So quite often they know the way. And if they don't know the way, if they meet someone, they can ask the way. So not only are you walking up with less effort, you're actually getting there quicker because you're going the correct route. And you're getting to have a conversation of sorts with someone. And you're giving someone some money back into the local community.
So how did the pace compare them with the bag and you without? Were you keeping pace with them or they were still
They were pushing it.
Yeah.
There was one chap, God, he was a young lad. And literally, he didn't want any money. I had a job to keep up. He must have been like sort of 14 or something. And he was off. He was just, whoa.
This is what they do.
Yeah,
and you're high up in the mountains. Yeah, altitude
yeah
as well,
you forget that. It's like 3,000 meters is a little bit harder.
So you pay someone to take your kit up.
Not every time, but yeah.
Yeah, you're on your next flying day now. How far into the journey are we at this point?
Not very far.
Nowhere near where we want to be.
My whole flying career has been about slow progress, right?
1992 to here. Yeah. I get it.
I've got another
time. There's a trend. Yeah. These guys better strap in.
You see why I don't need XP in that. I'm on a slow burn.
So was I during the XP. It's not a voluntary thing in the XP. Okay, so you're still very much at the beginning of the journey then. Have you got like a sense now of urgency or are you still just, you're lost in the fact that, hey, this is an adventure?
Yeah, so, there was no urgency.
Yeah.
Yeah. This is, I was playing it as it went. I think the key for me was to live the moment.
Yeah.
I had, in every respect, we talk about being scared or anticipating, you know, issues coming up. For me, it was about, it is what it is. If it rains, it rains. Where I am today is where I am. It's about being there, living it. I appreciated how lucky I was to be there.
Yeah.
I was lucky to meet those people I met. I was lucky to be flying up those mountains. And I likened it quite a lot to the fact that it's a bit like a mountaineer hitting a peak or someone running the first river. You know, I was running the first flight across these mountains and actually that was loving it.
How many times have paragliders took off from the mountains that you've took off on? None, you can pretty much safely say, right?
Yeah. I was making fresh lines.
That's always quite awesome. I mean, in the base jumping community, that's a big thing to open an object, you know, and in paragliding terms, lots of us paragliders will never experience that. So to be doing that, walking through and thinking I'm the first person to take off here is massively scary. And then also it's massively exciting. How are you with the psychology side of things? How are you thinking? How are you approaching each day? You know, at this point not a lot's gone on, but I guess at points fear would have crept in, or you know, there's been points where you've scared yourself or things have happened where you thought, oh, am I pushing it a bit here?
I had sort of the philosophy that actually, and I think paraglider pilots will appreciate this, the philosophy I had was actually the point of fear is probably as I'm about, let's put my point of fear of the flight at the point of takeoff. So the anticipation of the walk up, don't worry about it. You're not in danger. You haven't got yourself into any issues. Laying out the kit and eating that final snack and setting it all, packing it all into the backpack. You know, there's no point in worrying about it. Clipping in, cool. Check everything over. Keep a clean head. Make sure everything's in, everything's cool. Okay, better take off now. And I literally left the element of, oh, cracks, for want of a better word, until the moment I stepped off the mountain. And by doing that, I didn't actually develop the anticipation that could have killed the, I could have made a mistake on, I think that's how I describe it.
Yeah.
And I think you know yourself, Wes, that actually the minute you launch and the wing is tight and you are leaving that hill, the fear is gone and it's actually, yes, we're in the air again.
Exactly.
It's a short moment, and I kept it to a very small element of my flying.
Yeah, it's one of those things where having a bad landing is just sometimes part of flying, in the sort of flying that you're doing. Having a bad landing is to be accepted. It may happen, you know, because you're flying terrain. So, but having a bad takeoff is your fault. It's that simple. If you have a bad takeoff, you've made an error, you know. That might not be the case when you're coming into land, especially if the thorn bushes look like grass, you know. So I guess it is all about that initial takeoff. If I get this bit right and I get in the air, boom, this is the worst bit over and done with now. Yeah. Now let's just fly.
It was most days. There were a few days it went a little bit hairy. I suppose the two elements of being concerned after taking off, it was twice I found myself, and we'll show some footage, I hope, in a minute. I found myself in a valley with nowhere to land. It had been working all day, and both times it was really replicating the same scenario. So you get confident, you're moving down from valley, from spur to valley to spur, and you come over this one spur and you're in the next valley. And I describe it as sort of a scallop shaped type valley, where at the end it was very closed in with great big steep gorge, with a river coming up it, and the whole lot was just tree lined. And all there was, apart from the trees, but it wasn't trees, it was rocks, sheer rock faces, and the bottom was just a rough river.
No landing options, zero. It's a tree landing because you don't want to be in the river.
It's a tree landing. It wasn't really working. So I managed to get onto this rock face and maintain this rock face. And if we play the video on the flight shortly, you'll see my track does this on this rock face for quite a while, and I wasn't going anywhere, but I wasn't going down, fortunately. And then eventually I found the bubble, and eventually I had enough to get out of that valley. And that happened twice. That was quite concerning. And then I suppose the other point where fear really crept in, and I had a sort of a bad headspace moment thereafter, was I took off, this is probably about day 14, 15. I took off really late in the day. It was very unstable. And I talk about bad headspace day. I think the headspace day was the fact it started before I'd even taken off, and the fact I'd got to the top of the mountain really late. It was quite windy, which I hadn't had a lot of wind. And the wind was coming from round from the west. And I was hoping to take off from a south-facing slope, which was a little bit clearer, but it was just, the wind was just cutting round, and it wasn't possible to get the glider up out of the bushes. So I went round to a very small space to try and cobra it out of this, it was very small space indeed. And as I was standing there, I had two butterflies land on both of my thumbs. And I'm thinking, okay, is that good omen or bad omen? And I thought, frustrating thing was, I couldn't quite press the GoPro to capture the moment. But anyway, they flew off. So I thought, okay, that's a good omen. It's fine. I managed to get the wing up, flew out. I spent so much time climbing this mountain, getting ready, getting to the right takeoff. You sort of take your eye off the ball for the weather. And early on in the morning, there was a few puffy clouds. These things have now gone vertical. And I had a couple of major collapses. Say major collapses in the world of paragliding. It wasn't more than 50% in the wing, so it was a manageable collapse, no issues really. And this wing's pretty solid, really. But it was booming, and I needed to get out of there. And I had a job getting down. So
50% collapses in a place where you've got very little landing options.
So. Yeah, and they were quite close to each other. So that moment, you're going, "Oh, it's okay." Bang! It's
like, but, okay. Which quite often happens, right? Because you get one and you think, "Oh, I've dealt with it." Boom! The next one comes. So that's quite common. But to get that over an area where on the flatlands of the UK, you think, "Well, I can sort this out." But for that to happen in those spaces, because people who aren't flying paragliders or are listening, you know, if this wing collapses 50%, you lose 50% of everything you control. You're controlling one side of the wing. So now the immediate thing is get this thing flying again as quick as possible. And that's when you've got landing options. So to not have those options.
So I flew out into the valley, spiraled down, which is for non-paragliders. It's when you bank very hard and you go down a bit quicker than you normally go down. Down to this paddy field, pulled out to launch, back up again. So I literally landed in with my wing, big ears, those wingtips tucked in into this paddy field. And that's the time you don't want a reception.
Yeah.
You're landing there and your heart is going, you are sweating, you just want to just like hug the ground, and you get this crowd of people and you're thinking, bugger off.
Yeah. For those who don't fly paragliders, paraglider pilots look to the sky wishing they were there most of the time.
Yeah.
Sometimes we land glad that we're not in the sky anymore. And this sounds like it was one of those
times. It was one of those days. The only day I really had like that. But yeah, it was,
Yeah, it sounds sounds a bit hectic. Do you want to put that video on?
Can we play the video?
The video that correlates to what you just said, I guess. Yeah, this day. So you're well underway at this point. You're well in.
Well, this covers it all. So hopefully you can hear the sound on this one. Just have a breather.
Is there sound playing on there? Can people hear the sound playing on that? I'm not sure.
Yes.
Perfect. Is this that valley?
Yes.
I guess that video didn't end there.
No.
But you're keeping that to yourself for the movie, are you?
Yeah, you'll have to watch the final film to find out what happens there. But my explanation for those who are thinking I'm just rubbish at landing.
Is you rubbish at landing?
That was steeper than it looked. And I came in, just managed to reach the bit that I landed on. I tried to step back, and because I was carrying so much weight, I just fell backwards. But the rest of it remains for the film.
So for the non-paraglider pilots who would have now seen the terrain that you were describing, they might not understand the way that a paraglider stays in the air. Wind comes up a hill, and we soar on the wind, basically.
You can explain it this way.
Yeah, you don't really want much wind in a valley situation like that anyway. So we're hoping for not much wind, or thermals rise. They're a pocket of warm air, and we get on the thermals and we climb high. If you've got no thermals and you've got no wind, which you don't really want wind anyway, you're coming down, because people will think once the paraglider's in the air, you can stay in the air, so you can just cross these valleys. But that's very much not the case. And I'm guessing it didn't look very windy there that day either, but were you hit with, flying in the Alps and stuff, you get hit with some really bad valley winds that are quite dangerous. And is that the case here? Or I haven't heard you speak much about wind in your flying conditions.
No, I had valley winds a couple of times, and I had, the weather was, something I said was one of my biggest challenges, and actually there's a couple of times it was quite windy, probably too windy for me to take off in that location anyway.
Now, I mean, I know you, I've flown with you, and you're a safe pilot, you're very switched on, but you're ballsy. There's been times when we've been on hills and you've looked and you're like, what are you thinking? Like, yeah, and you're like, yeah, let's go then. Or I've looked at you and you're like, yeah. And so I know you're a ballsy pilot. So for you to say like it was windy for you,
yeah,
it's going to be pretty blowy
in those conditions.
Yeah,
because I think I remain the fact that I was by myself.
Yeah. So what's, we haven't touched on this, what's the what's your plan for injury and rescue, and is there, you know, a good air rescue service there? What have you thought about this, or have you put it to the back of your mind? Is it going to be like Bob on a hot air balloon, or is there, you know, a good chopper service?
Yeah, so my main point of reference for rescue was my InReach, which is this device, if you're not on the screen. So it's a little tiny Garmin InReach. That has a chance for me to talk to people via text messaging, and also has an SOS button, which I can press. And the rescue service that I paid and signed up for was one whereby if I didn't press it, and I also had live tracking on that as well. So every 10 minutes, it put a ping out for my location. Mm-hmm. And every night I'd put landed safe or taking off from here, just so that people back at home, and as a guy in Pokhara was looking out for me as well. So I had people monitoring my position. And if there was a situation where I had not moved for a while and I hadn't messaged that I'd landed safe, they could actually raise the alarm for the search and rescue. So that was the main sort of backup, I suppose. And I think I wouldn't have done it without it. For sure I wouldn't.
But there is a decent rescue service there. Or I guess you don't know because you didn't use them. But
well, there was plenty of helicopters out there. It remains to be seen.
But they're not, I mean, it's not a first world country. The infrastructure is not there, like flying in the Alps and stuff, I guess. So you're sort of hoping on the fact that people know how to navigate these mountains because they spent their life there, so they'll be able to get to me.
I think the first point of contact, if I had an accident, would most likely have been a local. I think, you know, it's very often, actually, there wasn't a lot of areas where you wouldn't find a person. There's, you know, there's a lot of shepherds grazing their sheep up in the mountains, so more than likely, if I had an accident, it would have been, the first responder would have been a shepherd or something. But I needed to get, if something had happened, I needed to get proper evac out of there, and that was the route to it, really. I saw one helicopter. It was the only aircraft I saw in the 3 weeks I was doing this Volbiv, and I think he came from Simikot, somewhere sort of far towards the sort of north end, and was passing by. At this time I was climbing in the thermal, and you could sort of see his helicopter pilot. I could read his mind. He came round and he sort of did a big massive circle around me going, what? Where?
What's airspace like out there? Any?
No. I was nowhere near anything to do with airspace.
Yeah. I thought that would be the case, but
an actual fact, in place like Mozzicott, which is where I had that collapse, Mozzicott has an airstrip halfway up the mountain, and there's one plane comes in there every day. Mm-hmm. And you literally I could have landed at the airport. It was like, that airplane came in at 10 and left at half 10, and that was it, you know.
So you're well on your way now, you're well in the journey, everything's going well, you've not really had any bad instances but a collapse, and you know, a few times over the bad valleys and stuff. But how are you adapting, and what do you make of like the rural life, the way that the people are living and the way that you're having to live, were you landing sometimes in thinking, wow, I'm more equipped than some of these guys are, or the way that I'm set up, you know, the comparative lifestyle to back home, what you were seeing, how did that compare?
Yeah, well, I mean, I got to see rural life firsthand and quite rural, rural life, you know, sort of really sort of isolated places that I was staying at. In simple, easy life is the best way of describing it. The sort of the farming families, they basically, it's handed down for the boys in the family. Farms might get split, but they have quite small farms most of the time. And they are completely self-sufficient. The ones that I sort of stayed with were probably only selling one item that they were producing. So, you know, it might be the goats, mm-hmm. or it might be some rice, but and everything else was for them. So, you know, they had the chickens, they had the pigs, they had the cow, they made the bread from the maize, they had a solar panel for the electricity, and to charging their mobile phone. yeah, and literally all they needed were a few things like salt and stuff. So completely self-sufficient, and, you know, seemed happy with it all, but they had their challenges, you know, whether it was wild boars destroying their crops, which could have left them in a bad state, or it was the fact that, you know, whatever else may have hit them, really. So I was very conscious that my interaction with them is a fine balance, whereby if I could add something to them, I would do, but I didn't want to take too much away at the same time. And I also became very aware that some of the more remote areas, the education factor was so key to the children's success and where they'd go in life. And the more remote it was and the poorer it was, many children did not get a chance for an education. Mm-hmm. But those that were being educated were really proud of it, looked really smart, and, you know, embraced the education. And you could sort of see a very positive vibe around those schools. So I was very much aware that there's a lot of difference between sort of the wealth within the rural communities as well.
So you were, and you felt welcomed all the time, every time you landed. Yeah. You never felt anywhere where you thought, actually, this is a bit uncomfortable.
No, and this is not... trying to play too much into it, but there is a problem with alcohol consumption in some place, yeah, with some people, and hash was quite prevalent in places. So those that had fallen out of the system, you know, that was their go-to substances. So you did come across that sometimes, but nothing aggressive ever. Yeah, really, totally welcome. Yeah.
Really helpful, really. Yeah. Yeah, because it's not really on the radar much, obviously, in Nepal, as you said, people aren't flying it. So to be the first person to go there and be greeted, you are an anomaly. You know, you don't know how you're going to be greeted, but the experiences that you're saying, they're the things that interest me, hence why I do these podcasts, because it's the interaction, the people I meet, the stories I hear, and the fact that you're being greeted like that is amazing. You say that some are learning English. There's English people there teaching them, or Nepalese people who have gone...
No, Nepalese people, our teachers are speaking good English and are teaching English, yeah. So, and all the children are trying to learn English. So they want to try and speak English with you if they can. And then that whole education, I was quite drawn into that. To one extent, I actually went to one school and talked about the paraglider. I'd flown over the day before. And then the teacher came to find me to say, come back to the school. So I went back to the school and, yeah, welcomed in. And it was a pretty damp day, so I wasn't
going
to
fly.
Missing my flying day. No, so it was a day I didn't fly and couldn't have flown. It started wet and got wetter. So I basically laid the glider out in the school yard. And they were saying, okay, you fly off here now? No, it's a sheer edge off the playing field down into a valley when there was a land. No, I'm not doing that. It's raining. My glider's wet. It's like, no, I'll show you on the ground, okay? So that was great. Yeah, it's just give something back. And a lot of the teachers I'm still in touch with. It was really, really some really good guys out there. So I'm hoping, you know, we'll talk about my sort of give back later perhaps. But what I'm hoping is actually give something back to these guys.
Yeah, which would be amazing. Mm. But so back to your journey, you're well established, you're going through now, you know, you've got past the midway point, and you're sort of approaching the end? Are you getting near to where you think you wanted to land? Are you getting near to completing it? Or maybe you don't want to say you want to keep it for the video, but are you well enough in that you think, yeah, this is on, like this is it for me. I'm gonna fly this.
Yeah, it's the weather deteriorated. Far west Nepal, as you're going deep, it's really good early on. It's a nice high pressure sits in there, which you can use. But as it goes into March, this is perhaps stuff I learned later, it becomes unstable, and particularly the route I was trying to take. So I came out to sort of the deep valley that runs up to Simikot, and then I was trying to get around onto the sort of the front mountains to run down to the Kaligamdaki Gorge and Dilagiri, which is the main sort of mountain range there. I was hoping to get onto this mountain range up to 8,000 meters, you know, yeah, get the selfie, get the glacier, get the oxygen. So that was
a long way for a selfie.
Yeah, yeah. So that was my ambition of actually the journey, was actually to position myself there to sort of, yeah, go, wow, you know, I am a mere mortal in the sky god position. But the weather deteriorated, and the base was quite low. It's at 3,500. So I found every day I was struggling to get across passes. Mm-hmm. So I was running valleys, but I couldn't get out of the pass at 4,000 meters. So I was walking out of valleys, which is like quite hard work. And quite often these valleys then would have snow on them. So it became trickier and trickier. So as my time went on, it got harder. Which should have been quicker, because I was running great ridges, you know, great mountain ranges, but actually it was tricky flying.
What, contrastly, what have you gone from? What's your good days? What meter a second climb? What sort of height is base? How long are you spending in the air to now this?
So best day, I think I did 65K climbs of sort of 4.5-5 meters a second.
Nice.
Yeah.
Big wide thermals, small punchy stuff, a mixture.
Yeah, pretty easy to stay in. Yeah, I've got all these vulture friends. They just it's here. easy to stay in thermals generally. Yeah, I didn't fall out of them. Just rank it up and round you go. Getting to, I think I got to sort of, I did 4,000 meters in my top dead of four. The I was hoping to get sort of above an inversion and go high, but the weather I had was, it's just basically overdeveloped. So it there was no inversion. It just boomed. So it went from 4,000 to 8,000 in the same cloud sort of thing. It's big stuff.
Yeah. Stuff that you stay away from. Yeah, definitely.
Totally, yeah.
So at what point are you now thinking, right, this is it? How far are you in when you're thinking like, this is probably coming to an end for me now? I'm struggling, I'm banging my head against a brick wall. Are we going to make it? How many days have you been in the mountains?
I think after about 15 days, maybe a bit more, 16 where I was, it was a case of, okay, forget trying to get to the eastern border. Let's get to Pokhara. Mm-hmm. Let's get there. And I had, you know, food was fine. I carried enough food for 10 days. Yeah. And you know, it was, and I was buying and eating places, so that was all fine. So my aim really was sort of, okay, Pokhara's the end game here. Let's just focus on getting there and covering as much ground as possible in the air, really. That was the sort of the remit. It's keeping motivated. Became quite, I suppose, if you were sort of, you know, the sort of, you know, how you're getting on, about day 15-16, it was the sort of the motivation became the issue, because it was hard work.
Yeah. Are you struggling now as well mentally? Because although you've got a lot of people around you and you're seeing red people regularly, they're not English people. You're not getting to share your frustrations. When you land in these villages, you don't want to offload your burden of the fact that, hey, look at me, I'm this first world guy who can't get this ball of material to fly over this mountain, because they're never going to get it anyway. Mm. They've got their own issues. So are you struggling mentally on the fact that you're on your own and you can't offload those burdens to people as well? Is that getting to you?
A bit. I mean, this is, you know, we haven't perhaps talked about, you know, going solo. I found myself talking to myself a lot, Wes. Out loud, Wes.
I'm not sure it's this sort of talk that we're doing, Tosh.
You do end up having to sort of have this, you know, external voice talking to you about, yeah, it's, you know, just keep going. But I think what I'd found, and I admire the guys that do the big stuff, 15, 16, 17 days, carrying 20 odd kilos, the energy you put into the thought processes of, you don't stop until you lie down at night asleep, because actually up until that point, you're still charging stuff, you're planning your next day, you're trying to walk up a mountain, you're taking off, you're mentally trying to plan your route in the air, trying to watch what's going on, trying to find the thermal. It took a lot more out of me than I think I anticipated before. Mm. You're not eating properly, you know, and as ill ones, you sort of slow attrition, I think, is probably what it was. The weather's against you. You're not getting great flights in. Sometimes it's just a glide and here we go again. And then, yeah, you land and you become very, I became very diligent. I had a real system for basically, right, okay, you land, that goes in that part compartment, that goes in that compartment, that goes there, and that goes there, and you're back, because everything has to fit in. So it's become like a system.
I guess also as well, like, sometimes too much of a good thing becomes a burden as well, because you land and you've got no one to share these things with, which is great at first, because they're just, you realize they're moments for you. I mean, this is why I'm doing this. This is because I wanted to do this and this is for me. But at some point, the good bits land, you land, the days, and you look around, you're like, who do I tell? The next person I'm going to speak to is not going to speak English. How do I share this moment? So I guess even when it's been really good, it very quickly comes down to boom, now we're back on our feet, or now we're back doing this, or now. Yeah. So I guess even after the good times, it's the most, getting that motivation is probably quite difficult again to plod on.
Yes, I think that the good times weren't too bad. I think it was the bad times that actually got to me more, to be fair. When I landed, I had a good flight, I didn't care. And I think 21, I left Kathmandu Airport, and then I arrived at Pokhara. It was the next person I saw that was from the West that spoke English.
Wow.
Yeah, it's actually, that scenario. But as I say, we had 4G. So I was, messaging, various people. Yeah. And actually that was quite good, just to sort of get that feedback of, and there was a couple of times I got some stuff back, which was a real, because actually you've got to appreciate here, it is now, as it is now, it's February or March. Weather in England is shit. You're having a really good time compared to most people. My bad days were quite good.
A walk across the pole would have been okay, actually. If you get to fly at all, you're doing well.
So you have to be quite careful how you sort of tempered your frustrations of the day when you got people who, you're sort of like putting it on Facebook and stuff, trying to keep the communication going, sort of saying, I had a shit day. No, it's not the wrong word. My day seemed challenging, but it's been okay.
struggling how you're going to write how good your day was is never a bad thing.
I was just conscious that actually, again, live the moment. But it was just that sort of moment when you're cold, you're wet, you've maybe lost a day, you've buggered up on the finding a takeoff, and come on, Tosh, you can do this.
Do you feel like you were prepared for it? Is there stuff that you wish you'd done, or do you feel you were over-prepared? What errors did you see that you think, well, really, I should have done this? Or, what would you change? Or,
I think I winged it quite well, actually. There were some things I wouldn't have taken and some things I would have taken, but there were small things. I would have taken something to climb out of a tree. If I ended up in a tree, would have helped that pressure. But I was pretty prepared, really.
Equipment-wise, you didn't think you took too much or anything?
No, I took a wind meter. What do I need a wind meter for? It's 2 meters to fly. It's 2 meters to fly. Why'd that end up in my bag? No, that's about right, I think, yeah. It was quite satisfying that actually nearly everything I took, I used, especially my one pair of pants.
They were well used. That one pair of pants came in really handy. So you feel like you want to go back, it's not completed, you feel like, or even if you completed it, let's say, you might feel like, no, this is, I want to fly irregularly, it's somewhere that has that draw for you, or it's something that's ticked off and you want to carry on somewhere else, or do you even want adventure anymore?
My wife watching. Something like a green card again. As far as I'm concerned, this project has reached a stage. If I'm unable to go back, you know, we've got a great film, great story to tell. However, as far as I'm concerned, the project is still live, and I want to go back to complete the journey. Mm-hmm. But I also know I had the far west of Nepal is so amazing. It is such a beautiful area of Nepal. The people that are so welcoming and hospitable, and the countryside is vast. I mean, it's deep. The Nepal is very deep there. The mountains of Himalayas and that part of Nepal are very deep. I'd be super tempted to go back to the beginning and start again.
Yeah?
Yeah, seriously.
Let me just, I'll cut you off 2 seconds just to remind everybody. Get your questions over to Sean now. If you do want to ask questions and you haven't already, send some over to Sean. He'll text them over to me, because I've specifically not asked some questions in anticipation that you guys might. So if there is anything you haven't heard yet, pop them over to Sean and shortly we'll go to Q&A. So yeah, sorry, carry on, mate.
Yeah, good distraction. So I mean, I'd love to go back. I mean, to me, I have done comps and don't really tick my box. I'm never going to win. They've taught me a lot about paragliding, but they're not where I want to go. Vol bib is where I want to go, and I just feel I've got a real association with Nepal now, and I'd love to go back to do more.
Also, it sounds like you could start in exactly the same place and have a completely different journey.
Yeah.
So, why wouldn't you go back and explore that? You know.
And there was one takeoff. I think particularly was just rad. It was just awesome, and you know. How come that's not a paragliding site? It was just beautiful. I mean, it's middle of nowhere, but you're looking at this perfect takeoff in the perfect location for connecting on some massive mountains. And it worked perfectly.
So there's no paragliding community within Nepal that you know of, or very small.
For sure. And there are, you know, a few people have flown areas of Mozikot in the past, which is, how far would it be? About 100K. West of Nepal. You know, people have flown there before, just stayed local to that. And you know, it's like Babu, who's flown all over Nepal, really. You know, Nepali guy who's famous for flying off Everest, and you know, he's a great pilot. And he's flown. I want to say that he's done a lot of the traverse on a tandem, in fact.
Oh wow!
So he's flown lots in different places. But in essence, there's no one doing anything where
I guess was. As well, logistics of being from Nepal, how do you get back to these places? If you're going in one direction, it's not so bad. Mm. But if you have to get home after each flight, would make it pretty difficult as well, I guess.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. So.
But it's also, you know, the infrastructure's not there. It's not like Pokhara with its bars and restaurants and bars. It's, you know, you've got to want to be roughing it, really.
Yeah. Which you... We're up for by the sound of it. So what was that takeoff that you, that was your favorite flight of the, of what's your favorite takeaway flight from the whole trip?
I think the first flight has to be probably up there. It wasn't the biggest, but it was such, the view was amazing. And the fact that it worked and I was with so many vultures, it was, and yeah, that part in the pool was, that was me. It wasn't the longest. It wasn't the most epic. It was just, it will sit there as being that sort of like bonkers best bit, really.
Yeah. I know. We'll go to questions and stuff shortly. I know it's going to come up, so I'm not going to ask you it yet, but they're going to ask when you're planning next and how quickly. So maybe think that over in your head. Are you going to answer that? But, I'm sure I'll get asked. We'll have a look at some questions now, just because I anticipate that there might be some in-depth ones. Let's see if I've heard my phone go, so there may be some been sent over to me. Let's see if Sean's sent me over any messages. Okay. So someone has said, I'm not sure who they are, so sorry, apologies to everybody if you have asked these questions. Where do we find the tracks you flew? Do you have them? Are they being saved for the movie? What are you... Okay, are you going to put them out there?
I will, yes. And actually, frustratingly, because actually I wanted to put them into XE contests at the time, but there's a time limit.
Okay.
So I left it too late. By the time I got back, I couldn't put the first one in, so I thought, forget it. So I've got all the track logs, and the route itself was kind of saving for the movie, to sort of, because it ties in with a lot of that. But I ought to, but once the movie's released, I will probably put a list of them on the website, so people can then upload them and replay them back themselves.
Yeah, like on a Duorama sort of style. Yeah. I don't know if it's called that anymore. So on there, you know, and people can play them back. So touching on the movie again, how are we looking movie production wise with COVID, this happened and stuff? Financially, is it impacted? Time scale, what are we talking? What are the impacts of this happened? Because I'm assuming that's the biggest reason it's not ready.
Yeah. So the idea is, rather than just producing a great YouTube video, we want to make, and who would, the paragliding audience would love, for sure. This is more than just paragliding, this journey. It's about the country, it's about the people, it's about the adventure, it's about normal bloke having quite a good time, but actually, you know, pushing the limits and having sort of experiences which you would never anticipate they're going to happen. So we want to make it into a film which we can put into film festivals and try and get some awards and try and get it out there as something which has a bit of a life about it. Because what I'd like to do is actually, once it's got a life, is actually then hopefully it'll raise some money, and then that can then put some money back into the two charities which I'm sort of selecting to sort of help the country that I've been across. The first is the Canali River Trust. I mentioned the Canali River. It's a sort of, you know, it's, there's a people out there trying to save that river from being dammed and being basically exploited for money by selling electricity to India, you know, to look after the environment that's there, to look after the people that live on the Canali River, and to save it for rafters, to save it for future generations. You know, it sits in a major earthquake zone. It doesn't want damming. And the other one is the Karma Flights, which basically is about sort of supporting children's education in the remote areas that we fly. So we want it to have a life that actually it will get to a level where actually you can send funds back. To do a production like that, we need some funds to get it to that level. So it's not a massive amount. It's, you know, about £5,000. So we've got a GoFundMe page up there now. We're currently just short of £1,000. We need to get to another £4,500. So, you know, part of the next process now is to push the GoFundMe, try and get people to throw what they can at it, £5, £10. Some people have been very generous, and actually get that so we can do a proper production. But yeah, it takes time to produce a decent film, as you'd know. So really it's about sort of, you know, trying to get the funding in, to get the production in, to get that film made.
And so all the links to that are on your website.
So yeah, on the nepaltraverse.com,
yeah,
there's links to the GoFundMe page on there, as there are links on the Nepaltraverse Facebook
your Facebook page as well. You can update people there as well. What, just before we get back to questions here, what sort of pilot do you consider yourself? Where do you think you sit in? Where do you, like, if you were to say experience level, etc., or, you know, an XC pilot or a competitive, where do you think you sit in if you had to say, this is me, this is what I want to do?
Pilot-wise? Oh, I'm a brilliant pilot. No.
I can confirm you're a brilliant pilot.
Because
you said earlier you're just a normal guy, just a normal pilot doing it.
I think because I learned so long ago, the wings I used to fly used to collapse like nothing else, and they were so unstable and it was so awful that I fly very safe now for fear they're going to actually, you know, go again. So I'm confident in my capabilities. I know my capabilities. But at the same time, I'm quite prepared to give it a go, I think, yeah. I would say is, if I'm going to big myself up, I'm quite good at taking off in tight spaces and landing in tight spaces.
I mean, I think it's, I think you were closer when you said earlier that you were a brilliant pilot, because I would say you're a brilliant pilot. How many hours do you get in a year, do you think? Because people might not know that you run a festival business that mainly operates during the summer at festivals. So you lose a lot of the paragliding time that we get. So how many hours would you say you're getting a year?
I think this year I'm just short of 80, which is probably a shock to a lot of people. but bearing in mind, not this year, sorry, 2020.
Yeah.
I haven't been flying all year so far. but then I was in Nepal. Yeah, so I normally average 60 to 100, I suppose.
Okay, so modest, really, considering what you've undertaken.
Yeah.
It is a modest amount, considering that lots of, you know, normal everyday flyers are well in excess of double that, I would imagine now. Okay, right, so back to questions then. Let's see what we've got. Oh, that was from Barna, actually, I think that says. Right, we've got from Nick Lloyd, which month did you do it? I think you covered that, right? It was early...
Feb, March, yeah.
Yeah, okay. What would you do differently next time if you would do it again? What you have taken from your trip, something you did not need and you would leave behind from Marcin? So you said there's nothing you'd have left behind?
Yeah,
or?
Yeah, I mean, the two I really picked out would be I didn't need a wind meter and I didn't need a dental floss to pull the rope up the tree when I stuck in the tree. I needed a rope climbing kit to get out of the tree.
Yeah, okay.
That's the one thing. And I was very conscious of that when I was flying those valleys. Because what happens is, Wes, the Nepalis burn wood for the fires, yeah? Mm-hmm. But the only they cut fresh wood so far up the tree. So all these trees, you think, oh, it's a tree, I'll land in that and climb down. They've got, as far as anyone can reach, no branches. So you might land in the tree, but then you'll kill yourself, break a leg, try and get out of the bottom bit, because there's no branches in the bottom bit. So you need something to cover that gap, yeah?
Yeah.
Was that the whole question?
That was the whole question of that one, yeah. Would it have been easier with a team to fly with? I know the answer to that one, I reckon. I might, maybe not, actually. That's from, I guess, Brian and Claire Greenwell.
Okay. It was one of the biggest quandaries I had was to whether to turn around to... you know, a good mate and say, you're going to come? You're interested?
Mm-hmm.
I wasn't short of people that would have said yes. Ollie. there were a number of, this quandary went on for quite a while. Clearly, safety would have been a massive one. You know, you were actually looking out for each other. But because I went by myself, I did it at my pace. There was no, I didn't compromise for anyone else. I didn't compromise anyone else.
Yeah.
I didn't need anyone in the air because I had enough vultures around to sort of mark thermals. So actually you didn't necessarily need another team pilot in the air. Being by myself, I felt I immersed greater into the culture of the country because I was always welcome and I was talking to them and not to someone else. And a lot of the takeoffs I was finding, you would not have got two gliders on. So what do? You take off first, well, firm, while the other guy then is waiting for the cycle or trying to get his wing out. So inevitably, there was a lot of issues, I think, around takeoff together. And I think a lot of pilots that have done it before have found the same on that. So it came down to, okay, I'm going to do it by myself. And to me, it presented sort of a personal challenge, which... and I think the only disappointment with that, if I had a disappointment with being by myself, is the footage from another glider of a glider on the terrain that we're on, because you can't necessarily appreciate what you're flying from your harness. You could do with someone else filming the other person flying.
Yeah, perspective.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That makes so sense. On the other question, what would I take next time? If I went back, I'd take a small drone and I'm working on different camera locations for a third person perspective, but that sort of drone footage of, you know, walking the ridge line with the perspective of the mountains behind and that sort of stuff. More kit, more time.
I mean, you didn't go with the idea of making a film this time, so next time you would go a lot more in the idea of, wow, this can be made into a great film.
I came back and realized actually that was a footage that we're really missing for this, the Portraverse film.
Yeah.
But, you know.
Yeah. Okay. So we've got, when flying east, you had the Himalayas to your left and the lowlands to your right. How did you judge the ideal line to take, left high versus right low, from Nick Lloyd?
Good question. I tried to go as deep as I could most of the time.
Hoping that the mountains would work better.
Yeah, no, you know, it's the dream of getting onto high stuff and above in an inversion if it happened. There were a couple of times I got thrown off course. I came from, this probably doesn't mean lots of people, but basically I came past Champer, sits right up in the Sapi Mountains, and I couldn't get out of that bowl because I had peaks of sort of 4,000 meters to climb over. So I had to come south and go down a valley, which I crossed beautifully, got to the other side, and then I had a Dora Mountain, which is at 8,000 meters. And when I got there, that kept overdeveloping, so I couldn't. I was hoping to go straight over it, of course. And you look on the map, you're thinking, yeah, straight over that. And I couldn't get it, just developed overdeveloped so quickly every day. So I went north or south, and I decided to go south because it would sort of be a straighter line. I wish at that point I'd gone north up to the Rara Lake, which I think would have then presented possibly better weather for the next 4 days afterwards. Whereas actually, I was then fighting close to the lowlands and getting the sort of the brunt of the weather. Mm-hmm. I tried to go as deep as I could with the height that I could fly.
So in retrospect, you do that differently next time. You think you'd approach that differently?
You fly the weather, you fly the day, really. For sure.
You think you held yourself back through caution of not knowing it
too
well?
Not being able to fly. When you're actually walking over 4,000 meter pass, that's
you're in
high,
cloud.
That's as high as you're going.
Exactly. Russ Locke here said, what advice for helping the communities that were so hospitable? Well, you said that those links are going to be on there and on the Nepal Traverse website and via Facebook. So please do all look them up.
And I think on that note, it'd be quite nice to sort of, this is trying to get the whole project live, is to basically feedback what we're doing. And I'd like to sort of say that actually, We support a school that sponsors a couple of children to basically come to school, which couldn't have gone to school, and we follow their story as well. Yeah.
That'd be amazing, definitely. Yeah. And so the last one was looking for flying partners, or would you go along alone again? I guess you've pretty much answered that, in that you're not saying you'd definitely do it alone, but you see the benefits of doing it alone, and you don't see that there'd be too much benefit of having somebody else with you.
No, but I'd also. In these dark nights of where are we, January, you do start thinking about it'd be quite cool to go over a bunch of guys and go, if I was to sort of say, okay, I know a great place to start, I know some great places to get to, it'd be a hoot, wouldn't it? And a different perspective, really.
How would the logistics of having a driver be? Someone in a van who just, okay, if they don't meet up with you in 2 days, it doesn't make a difference, but in 3 days' time we head here.
No, I mean, there's plenty of different ways of getting around. Yeah. I think it would just be
a hindrance.
Carry your own bag.
Carry your own bag. You're in no position to say that. Okay. Chucking £7 at some poor boy to carry your bag.
No. You wasn't poor after I left.
So the question that didn't come up actually was, when would you be thinking? I mean, obviously we can't, because of this, we don't, the virus, we don't know. But when would you be thinking in your head? Would it be a case of get the movie together, get that over and done with, and then think about the next flight? Now the movie's the real big part. Yeah, you wouldn't consider doing another adventure and then collating it to one movie?
No, I don't. We've got enough to make a great movie.
Yeah.
Nepal's shut to UK people at the moment. I am half keeping an eye on it. and I suppose the beauty of it is, we've got two flying opportunities. You either go February, March, or you go October, November. And it'd be quite nice perhaps to go in the back end of the year, but it depends on restrictions and work and that sort of thing.
Gavin McClure said, don't forget the GoFundMe. Gavin McClure, don't forget the GoFundMe. So I guess it's nice to know that people are out there and they know that there's a real big thing here.
Nepal Traverse, where did I get the idea for that name from? The Alaska Traverse,
that what Gavin gave you? And you asked Gavin for advice, he said, I got a cool name.
No. But that's the inspiration, is it? And I think, fair play to Gavin. He didn't big that, we know he's an amazing pilot, but he didn't big it up as being something about him. It was about the sort of the journey and about the sort of the adventure. And, that was a lot of the driver for me. It wasn't, I didn't have to necessarily put myself into a position where I was going to, not come back. I mean, I had that thought when I left, I suppose, you know, it's, no, I'm leaving, I might not come back. But yeah, I knew I didn't have to do that. And I think, you know, it's nice to sort of see other pilots out there who play the adventure of this sport in a way which actually gives them an adventure, but actually they know the limits. And I think that's the key of it, really.
Yeah, I think from flying with you, I think you you demonstrate that very well, especially in the UK. You and I have travelled to North Wales on a day in the hope, oh, it doesn't work, well, let's just go get an ice cream somewhere, and then the day's over. And so I know that of you. But I think you're, for anyone who doesn't know you, the greatest thing for me would be they come up and say hello to you on a hill now.
Yeah.
They see you on a hill. If you're not a paraglider pilot, if you see them in the supermarket, say hello. But if anybody sees you, if anybody sees you, on a hill, you are a very approachable pilot, but you're a very good pilot, and you're very, you know, people should come and introduce themselves and fly with you. It's great fun.
Absolutely. And I'm a coach in South East Wales now, and my daughter's, you know, she's a club pilot, and I'm trying to coach her. For me, it's about, and I'm, you know, the sites officer for South East Wales, about actually, you know, maintaining the sport for as many people as possible, because it's an amazing sport to be in, as we know. Yeah, it's like no other. And it's getting better as far as I'm concerned in terms of the way the kit's coming along. The whole Volbiv boom is actually, yes, this is the new thing for everyone. And I think a lot of people are interested in it. I think I'd be really happy to sort of try and support that whole Volbiv community. I'm not saying I am the most experienced out there. I've got loads to learn, but I've got bits to share.
So what would be your advice? Last question. What would be your advice for lower hours, or people who want to pursue Volbiv? What would be your advice? Where would you say go and do, not go and do? What would you say to focus on for the guys who want to follow in your footsteps?
It's about breaking the ice. Do it in your own, on your own flying site. Just go cross country. You don't have to go cross country. You can just basically hike up a mountain late one evening, camp out in the mountain, and get your first top to bottom in the morning. It doesn't have to be anything epic, but what's the part of the whole starting to do Volbiv is to basically carry something you can cook and sleep in.
Yeah,
it's fun. It's camping. Yeah, you know, it's camping with a wing. It's exactly what it is. And you know, do that. You know, camp with a wing and fly.
Yeah, I think from my point of view, the greatest bit about your journey has been this talk tonight. I've absolutely loved it.
Well,
I would have loved to have got more from you, but I know you've got a movie coming, and there's things we can't press on because the movie, you know, the movie's coming. So hopefully once the movie's out, we can catch up again and we can talk about how the movie's been received and stuff. But I love talking to you anyway. We talk a lot, so I knew that. But hopefully other people who don't know you have listened to this and thought, what a cool guy. It's been an absolute pleasure. Yeah. Thank you, like, unequivocally from everybody. Once again, thank you to Avon Hang Gliding and Paragliding Club. This has been recorded. It will be shared. It will be available on the 8-1 podcast YouTube channel at some point. The links will go out, etc. I'll upload just the audio version to the 8-1 podcast. So that'll be available as well. Other than that, Tosh is really approachable. Get in contact with him. I want to see the hits double on your website overnight, right? That's how we need it to go. But yeah, other than that, we have got others of these planned. There is, I think, the 28th. Sean will correct me. It might not be the 28th. I think it's the 28th for Jim Mallinson. Another talk similar to this. So please do join us for that. But I think the best way to play this out rather than logging off is if we can see the movie trailer, please, Sean. And again, thank you all very much, and we'll see you again.
And Wes, thank you, mate.
Oh, thank you.
I want to give you a hug.
Virtual hug. There we go.
Yes. Yep. Next time.
Next time.
I live for the adventure that I think. doing this solo. I don't think anyone else was going to come with me.
Thanks, everybody. I'm going to close the session down now. Join us in a couple of weeks' time, 28th. We've got Jim Mallinson. Thanks for staying with us. See you all soon. Cheers, guys.
I'll see you. Cheers.